Before we jump into our sermon today, I'll read our text for us. And I'm going to read from the ESV. We've been going through the book of Mark here. This will be Mark 14, 26, until I stop reading. There's a lot of little verses in here. All right. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus said to them, "You will all fall away, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Even though they all fall away, I will not." And Jesus said to him, "Truly, I tell you, this very night, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times." But he said emphatically, "If I must die with you, I will not deny you." And they all said at the same time, and when they went to a place called Gethsemane, he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." And he took with him Peter, James, and John, and began to be greatly distressed and troubled. And he said to them, "My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch." And going a little farther, he fell on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour that might pass from him. And he said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." And he came and found them sleeping. He said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy, and they did not know what to answer him. And he came the third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." And immediately, while he was speaking, Judas came, one of the 12, and with him a crowd with swords and clubs, and the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Seize him and lead him away under guard." And when he came, he went up to him at once and said, "Rabbi," and he kissed him. And they laid hands on him and seized him. But one of those who stood by drew his sword and struck the servant at the high priest and cut off his ear. And Jesus said to them, "Have you come out against a robber with swords and clubs to capture me? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not seize me. But let the scripture be fulfilled." And they all left him and fled. A young man followed him with nothing but a linen cloth about his body, and they seized him. But he felt the linen cloth had ran, but he left the linen cloth and ran away naked.
My sermon title this morning, I gave it the very cheery title, "Wanting to Die," and hopefully by the end of listening to my sermon, that does not describe yourself, or maybe in the midst of listening to it. I guess you never know. It might be a real stinker. Who knows? But in case you're wondering, the sermon title, it is not in reference to myself, to you, or to some sort of action that I am wanting you to do, but rather, as you probably guessed as reading the text, it's pointing back to Jesus and something that he wanted to do, and why it's actually a good thing that he felt this way at this time. But before we get going on this, let's pray. Father, I thank you that you are good to us, and I thank you that you have sent Jesus to us, that we can have confidence before you because of him. And Lord, we ask that we would receive now everything that he has to give us. In your name we pray. Amen. So our text, it begins with Jesus and his disciples in the Garden of Gethsemane. And Jesus is telling his disciples, "You will all fall away. For it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I'm raised up, I will go before you to Galilee.'" Now, the last couple of weeks, as we've been looking at Jesus' life through the book of Mark, the theme of Jesus' betrayal has been coming up quite a bit, As Jesus is first prophesied that he will be delivered over to the chief priests, the authorities, we don't know who's going to do it. And then it comes clear that, oh, well, it's one of the 12. Then we find out, oh, it's Judas. And now, Jesus is essentially telling them, you know, earlier you were wondering who this person was that was going to betray me. Well, in your own way, it's you. You are going to betray me. None of you is going to follow through with what you have said you would do for me. And of course, Peter, who just, he just always seems to be the guy who promises more than he can follow through on. He just talks when he should really just kind of shut up. He opens his mouth and he says, Jesus, even if they all fall away, I will not. But Jesus, of course, knows otherwise. And he soberly predicts that before the rooster even crows twice that very night, Peter would have already betrayed Jesus three times. He would already have denied him. And Peter, obviously not remembering the last 3 years and that Jesus is just never wrong, he opens his mouth again and he says, Jesus, if I have to pick between dying for you or renouncing you, I will die for you gladly. And then the rest apparently said the same sort of thing. And they all overestimate themselves. So Jesus goes off to pray, and he asks for support from supposedly his best three disciples, or at least the ones who think they are the best. It's James, John, and Peter. And yet, despite their confidence in themselves, they repeatedly fall asleep on him. Judas, eventually he comes with an armed rabble of thugs. They arrest Jesus, and everyone flees. One of them even has to resort to streaking to get away, which is just a curious little addition in there, you know? They all make wonderful promises, and they all fail to keep them. Every single one. In this account, it reminds us of something that is just so core to our experience as humans. By nature, we are completely unaware of how weak we really are. As Christians, we like to think that we are committed to Jesus, that nothing could shake our faith. And yet, on our own, we are powerless to hold fast to Christ. You know, we make these amazing promises to God, but we can't keep them. You know, we all like to think that we are righteous and courageous in the face of evil, but the rest of Scripture reminds us that none of us are righteous. No, not one. All have turned away. It was true for the disciples, and it's true for you and me. And I'm reminded of a conversation that I had as a teenager with my old pastor that I just kind of wish I could go back in time and just slap myself for having, because I was just kind of dumb. I can't remember exactly the details surrounding it, what specifically was being talked about, but the general gist of the conversation goes like this. My old pastor, he was telling me that I needed to do something to avoid some sort of temptation. And I just wasn't really having any of it. I was like, yeah, I guess that's cool for other people and all. But yeah, I'm not going to do that. And then he asked, Matt, so what are you going to do when you end up failing? And I responded with something along the lines of, dude, you have no idea how stubborn I am. You have no idea how hard-headed I am. And in a lot of ways, that's bad, but in this way, it's really great. If I don't want to do something, I'm not going to do it. Or if I want to do something, I'm going to do it. And then I made some sort of a claim like Peter had made, only to, just like a short time later, to completely go back on it. Completely to show how much of a fraud I was, how much of a failure I was, how weak I really was, even though I thought I was strong. What I didn't know then, and what we all do not truly understand the significance of in our daily lives, is that we are desperately weak against sin. We think we're strong, but we're not. And even worse than being weak against sin, we think that we're strong. You know, we think that we can't be taken down, but and the problem with that is at least a weak person who understands their limitations isn't going to do something that they think that they know that they can't do. If you're going to be weak, at least know that you're weak. But we have the issue where we're weak and we think that we're strong. We act like we're superheroes that have no need for help. And in reality, we need help for everything. And even more critically, the thing that we need the absolute most, which is a right relationship with God, we are completely powerless to get on our own. The thing we need the most, we are completely powerless to get. And yet we grasp for it ourselves. We make these wonderful promises to God. We bargain with him. I'll do this if you do this for me, God. You know, I'll do this and you'll accept me then, right? And yet we're all liars. We're all failures. We make promises that we can't help but break. And yet, Jesus knows that. He isn't shocked by our betrayals. He certainly wasn't shocked by his disciples' betrayals. You know, even the one who next to Judas, he knows will betray him worse than the rest, he brings to be closest to him. Peter. You know, he cares so much for Peter, even though Peter will, in just a few short hours, prove to care so little for Jesus. You know, even while Jesus is going through the greatest turmoil that he experienced in his life, while he's in the midst of it, while he's going through that, he is concerned for Peter in his well-being. He's concerned about his soul. You know, he's concerned for him and the rest of the disciples because of what is going to happen when they are tested. And so he tells them all, come, watch, pray with me. And now we can't deny, because it's right here, we can't deny that Jesus is seeking comfort and companionship from them. He is seeking to get something from them. We can't deny that. There's nothing bad to deny there. We can't get away from that. But look at verse 38. It makes it so incredibly clear that Jesus is concerned with his disciples' well-being. Why has he asked them to come pray? It's not just for him. It's not just for companionship. It's not just for comfort. It's also for them. He knows that their flesh is weak. He knows that left to their own devices, they will reject everything good that Jesus has given them. Jesus also knows that the answer, at least in part, to that weakness that they have is to stand watch in prayer. The answer, in part, is to turn your eyes to God, to refocus your attention away from the temptations of this life, and to instead focus them upon the God who is above them all. And to the extent that you can see God's presence in your life, you will not fall prey to temptation. You will be able to avoid temptation. The problem, of course, though, is that we are all so weak. And that we all too easily turn our eyes away from God. We don't spend that time in prayer. We are not endlessly in prayer. We get tired. And we think that we'll be just fine if we just go about our lives as normal. But Jesus knows the temptation to sin that we are under. And part of the answer to that temptation is to flee to the presence of God, to pour out our hearts to him, and to ask him to reshape us into what we were created to be. To say, let not my will be done, but yours be done. Jesus knows the temptation that we're under. He went through it himself. You know, there's perhaps no other story of Jesus' life that has troubled theologians and philosophers who try to understand who Jesus is than this passage. This is one of the most problematic ones for people because there is no clearer example of Jesus' human and divine natures being together than is recorded right here. Jesus knows what is about to take place. He even knows the details of how Peter is going to betray him. You know, it isn't just a story of a man who's got swept up in a movement and he's now just reacting to things. That's not the Jesus that's presented here. This is a man who is fully aware of what's going on and he's fully in control. He is divine. Okay? He isn't a victim in this sort of thing here. And yet, he also makes perhaps the most startling claim that you could ever expect a divine to make. He says, "My soul is very sorrowful, even unto death." Or more plain words, "I am so sad that I wish I could die." Death would be better than this. The one who created all life, the one who brought everything good into being, he wants to die? What's going on there? You know, it's not as though Jesus is in a depressed funk where he can only see the bad in the world and he can't see any of the good in it. It's not as though that's going on. And it's not as though he is suddenly having second thoughts about redeeming humanity. It's like, "Oh, you know, I thought I'd redeem him, but actually, I better things to do." That's not what's going on. And yet, in this moment, Jesus seems to understand something that absolutely terrifies him. Something is about to happen to him that is worse than death. As Jesus expresses on the cross, the only words that Mark records, and as the apostles later clarify, Jesus was not just about to be separated from his physical body. He was about to be separated from God the Father. He was about to be abandoned, and it terrified him. You know, where once there was only perfect fellowship, there was now going to be separation. Where once God the Son was in perfect peace and harmony with God the Father and God the Spirit, now there would be war and wrath. Jesus was about to take on the full weight of the sin of all humanity, and God the Father was going to crush him. And so in the garden, Jesus prays, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." He doesn't want to go through with it. And yet, in prayer, he submits. And he agrees to do it anyway. It's almost, so what many people have noted here, it's almost as if Jesus is schizophrenic here. On the one hand, Jesus came to earth. God the Son came to earth because he wanted to die so that he might redeem humanity from their sin. You know, but yet on the other hand, he'd rather die so that he doesn't have to go through with what he is about to go through with. So he doesn't have to go through with all that this really means. You know, in this way, his description of Simon Peter in verse 38, it also kind of points back to himself in a way. You know, on the one hand, the spirit is willing, but on the other hand, the flesh is weak. Here in the garden, you have the Son of God, the omnipotent creator of the universe, who is controlled by no one and only does that which he wants to do. But within the same person, you have the Son of Man, the Son of Mary, one who is weak like we are weak. One who is overwhelmed at the terrifying prospect of what is about to happen to him. And what does this Son of God and this Son of Man do in that terror? He prays. He goes to prayer. He addresses God as he alone is to be addressed. He says, "Abba, Father." And then he confesses the truth about who God is, that he can do all things. There's nothing outside of his control. And then he pours out his heart in honesty. He says, "I don't want to do this. Please take this cup away from me, if it's possible. I don't want to drink it." But then he submits to do what God the Father had sent him there to do. He receives the life that God the Father had given him to live. He doesn't reject it. He receives it. Here in the garden, Jesus accepts in full the mission that God the Father had given to him. And he is the contrast with Adam. In the garden, Adam and Eve, they rejected the gift that God had given them, and they went to the tree that they were not given. But here in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus receives all that God the Father has given him to receive. And shortly thereafter, that reception of that life, Jesus' acceptance in full of the mission that God the Father had given to him, that was tested. And at the same time, those zealous disciples who claimed to have accepted the mission that Jesus had given them, they end up proving to be liars and cowards as they flee from persecution. Jesus is truthful. The disciples are failures. And as we'll see more of next week, the contrast between Jesus and the rest of the disciples, but especially Peter, is just so striking here. If you have your Bibles open, you just scroll on down, and you can see that what we'll be talking about next week as well. You know, Jesus knows his own weakness as a human, and he prays for strength as though prayer is his lifeline. But Peter, on the other hand, he can't keep watch in prayer for even an hour. You know, he doesn't think of prayer enough to even pray for an hour. You know, Jesus, he views his upcoming suffering with painful clarity. But Peter, on the other hand, he views the potential of his suffering with rose-tinted glasses, promising more than he could ever follow through with. Jesus is willing to be lied about and mistreated all for the sake of others, but Peter is going to lie to save his own reputation. You know, even in the eyes of someone so insignificant as a slave girl, you know, Jesus is going to stick up for others. He's willing to do that, knowing that it's going to cost him even more than his physical life. But Peter will abandon Jesus, even though he doesn't even know what the consequences of following Jesus might be. Jesus will take on the curse of God willingly, knowing that by doing that, he is going to save others. Peter will kind of feign a little curse on himself. He'll swear a curse on himself, all for the sake of saving himself in the eyes of someone else. Jesus is faithful towards those whom he does not need to be faithful to. But Peter proves to be faithless towards the only one to whom he must be faithful. The contrasts here, it can't be any more clear. Jesus is so different than Peter. And I suppose the question remains, well, why? Why is Jesus so different than Peter? And I suppose that we could just point out that Jesus is the God-man and Peter is just a man, but it's more than that. You know, the character of Peter, like all of us, was to be self-serving. We care about our own good, our own well-being. But Jesus, on the other hand, ultimately cares about our good. He cares about us. You know, God created us. Look at our creation. Why were you created? You were created because God wanted to show love. He wanted a creation that he could have a relationship with and could give himself to provide everything for them. Out of the communal love between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, God created us. We are the products of love. You were created to be shown affection to. That's your purpose in life, is for God to show affection to you. But the story of man and women is that we run away from that love. We ran away from that love in the garden, and we fled into the arms of another. You know, we fled towards the mistress of death and destruction. And now by nature, we are continuing to run towards it. We desire the things that are harmful for us, the things that destroy us. You know, we do catch glimpses of good in God's creation, but so often we twist it in our selfishness and we turn it into just another weapon to use against others. And God saw us in our rebellion, and he says, "This is not good. You cannot be with me when you are like this." But he didn't just see us in our rebellion. He didn't just see us in our sin. He also sees us as he created us, as people that he values. And so, he came down here so that he might rescue us from our sin, to make a way to win us back from our mistress of death. And he came down here knowing full well that he was going to have to die in order to win us back. And he did so willingly. And in the garden, you see that. In Jesus' humanity, we see the weakness that he needed to put on in order to save us. And in Jesus' divinity, we see the desire of God to love us no matter the cost. In this person, you have the will of God coming to fruition. You know, he could have renounced his claim on us, but instead he made it even stronger. And so in a similar but more truthful way than what Peter claimed earlier in our passage, Jesus essentially says, "My beloved creation, if I have to choose between dying for you or renouncing you, I will die for you. I'll do it gladly. Let me prove it." And over the next few weeks, we're going to see just how he did. And so what does this mean for you today? What does it mean for you that God chose to die for you, that Jesus in the garden chose to drink that cup, that bitter cup for you? Well, it means a couple of things. And first, I want you to think back to the conversation that I had with that pastor that I kind of wish I could slap myself for. Think back to the question that he asked me. What are you going to do if you fail? What are you going to do if you fail? When you make these promises to God, you claim that you trust him. You claim that, you know, I am committed to him. And then you look at yourself in the mirror and you find out, I'm a liar. I have not followed through with what I have said I would do for him. What do you do with that when you fail? Now, you could do what Adam and Eve did in the garden. They fell from God. They rejected him. And what did they do? They ran and they hid. They knew their shame and they ran from him. You could do that, but you don't need to. You don't need to do that. Because of what Jesus did for you here, it means that you don't need to worry about screwing up too much or somehow losing God's forgiveness of you. He came for people who would deny him. He came for people who are sick. He came for people who are not well. He came to demonstrate his love for you, to demonstrate his commitment to you, to people like you and me who don't deserve that commitment, who don't deserve that affection. This is the man who went to hell and back for you. Literally. You know, your sin is not going to shock him. And it's not going to make him go back on his promise to you. The gift that he has given to you, the gift that God has given to you in Jesus is firm. It's based in the unmovable desire of God to show his love for you. That's the first reason why it matters. Here's the second. The reason why it also matters for you today is that you can trust everything that he gives you is for your good. You can know that it is for your good. Everything that he has to give you, anything he calls you to in this life, it's not to manipulate you. It's not to give himself something that he needs. It's for your good. You know, and so when he says that you are weak and you need to pray so that you don't enter into temptation, you can take that to the bank. You can trust that. You know, a lot of times we, and I'll admit that I am so included in this. A lot of times we can think that the reason we should pray or the reason that we should read our Bible or that we should go to church is because God needs that from us. Can get into that way of thinking. It's as though, you know, he needs to see how much we appreciate him and that when we don't follow through, we're really letting him down here and he's disappointed with us. And if you're wondering if that is how you sometimes approach this whole Christian life, why don't you just ask yourself these questions? When you don't read your Bible as often as you know you should, do you feel like a failure in God's eyes? When you miss a Sunday, do you feel like you need to make it up to God? When you fall asleep in prayer or you lose focus, do you feel like God is angry with you? If you answer those questions with a yes, as I often do, the reason why is that you're approaching your spiritual life in entirely the wrong way. God didn't give you the Bible because he needs you to read it. He gave it to you because you need it. Your mind is corrupted by sin, and it needs to be renewed by the Holy Spirit who works through the Word of God. You need it. You know, God didn't give you the church because he needs a group of people to give glory to him, as though he doesn't need any more. He has it all. No, he gave the church to you because you need a group of people to come alongside you, to spur you on, and to remind you of the gospel. God didn't give you prayer because he needs to be wanted and to hear your secrets. He gave you the gift of prayer because you need it. Your heart needs to be honest with someone. It needs to be honest before the only one who won't judge you, the one who won't reject you or make you feel as though that you don't matter anymore because of what's in your heart. You need someone like that. And in prayer, he's given that to you. You know, the fact of the matter is that you can trust and receive everything that God has to give you, everything that he's called you to do. You can know that it is for your good. And you can know that that is the case because Jesus wanted to die for you. He thought that that was better than to leave you in your sin. He gave up everything so that he might give you everything. Let us pray. God, I thank you for Jesus and what he has done for us. Lord, may we receive that forgiveness that he has given to us. May we not run from you, but run to you. In your name we pray. Amen.